This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. One of our favorite guests is back with us today. Nick Redfern is here to talk about alien abductions. You know Nick's work, of course, and if you're a subscriber, you can listen to the many shows that we've done together over the years. Always fascinating stuff. He's the author of the NASA conspiracies. He's been on Ancient Aliens and UFO Hunters. He's been on the National Geographic's Paranatural show. He has been on, it says here on his book, more than 70 TV shows. I wouldn't be surprised if it wasn't more than 100. Nick, welcome to Dreamland.
Hey, Whitley. Well, thanks for having me on again.
Well, good. Well, today we're going to be talking about alien abductions. And since I am an alien abductee, I am going to be asking Nick a number of questions about my own experience. This means that those of you who send me emails saying, we don't want you to talk, we just want you to ask questions, had better listen to another broadcast, because that is usually what I do. But I am also, as far as I know, the only close encounter witness with a podcast of this size. Therefore, I feel obligated when somebody who has done this kind of research is on the show to bring some of my own questions as well. Nick, let's start. You made a decision at some point fairly recently, because you do write your books rather quickly, to get into the alien abduction phenomenon. Why did you do that?
Well, the main reason, Whitley, was that, as you know, of course, a lot of books over the years have been written on the abduction phenomenon. I mean, dozens and dozens, quite literally. And I wouldn't have really written a book on the subject at all had it not been for the fact that there was a new, not so much a new angle, but a more expanded angle for me to look into. And by that, I mean that, you know, the big question is, well, what can be added to the average alien abduction book? You know, it's the same scenarios, even though they're deeply interesting stories. But over the years, I've sort of collected, if you like, from people who've contacted me, accounts and stories from abductees where there seems to be a significant degree of what we would call sort of government surveillance surrounding the cases and the people. And the more I dug into this, the more leads and threads and people I got to speak to, etc., and to the point where I was eventually able to write a book on this particular lesser-known angle, namely the surveillance of the abductees. And I thought, you know, it would be sort of a new angle, if you like, for people to sort of take a look at and realize that this phenomenon, the abduction phenomenon, appears to attract people within the military and the intelligence community.
Yeah, it did in my life, certainly, because any number of times when the implant was put into my ear in May of 1989, and for those of you who are aware of the fact that it says 1994 in one of my books, please know that that's a typographical error and nothing more. In any case, it was two people who came into the room, but they were obviously being supported by someone outside, because when I opened my eyes, noticing movement, I was only half asleep. It was 11 o'clock on a May night. And, I heard a voice outside say, "Condition red." Then they rushed toward me. But the interesting thing is, I've always sensed that there was something else there, something behind them. I can't be sure of that because it all happened so quickly. But it was definitely a man and a woman. I could identicate them to this day. Their faces are burned into my memory. Now, what do you make of that?
Well, what I make of it is that it's sort of yet another example of what appears to be some degree of what we call surveillance, spying, monitoring. And, you know, I think certainly the times have changed a bit, certainly with the, you know, the advent of the internet, to where it's far easier today to sort of keep tabs and on people and watch them and, you know, and follow their activities, etc. I'm talking about, you know, like a government surveillance, rather than the old days of wiretaps and mail interference, that kind of thing. But I've spoken to a lot of abductees, and nearly all of them at some point have had something along those lines where something made them think, huh, you know, that somebody's listening in or somebody's watching, that kind of thing. So for me, it's having written this particular book, it doesn't come as any surprise that abductees, and particularly ones like yourself who are in the, you know, have high profile, it doesn't surprise me at all that this kind of thing happens.
Yeah, well, I wonder who these people were, though, because they were in possession of extraordinary technology. Mm. They, for example, put the implant in my ear without opening an incision or leaving a scar. They pressed it through the skin. Now, we don't have anything remotely like that. When they left the house, they left behind a powerful magnetic field that kept the garage door alarm from functioning. A magnetic field so powerful that the whole garage door was all the way open, and the switch wasn't tripped because the magnetic field was incredibly powerful. Mm. We had no way to know where that magnetic field could have come from. It could not have come from the magnets in the switches. Mm-hmm. So they seem to be in the possession of technology that's pretty far beyond what we know today. And I want to know if you think that they could be somehow connected to aliens or whatever the visitors are?
Mm. Well, that's a good question, because there are some cases, not a large number of cases I've got, but probably 9 or 10 cases where people have actually, or abductees and contactees, have claimed to have been seen entities that look very much like us or identical to us, but who seem to have access to highly advanced technology. For example, one of the people I interviewed for a previous book, named Felix Garnett, who lives in England, told me how he had a very, very strange experience with this man and woman, sort of like a man in black and a woman in black, and literally sort of manifest in the bedroom, and where they were talking about how, almost in like an amused way, looking at our technology and from the perspective of, wow, are they still using this? It was almost like a time travel type story, you know, of somebody, of these people coming back and just sort of checking us out and but being amused at our technology. So I do have a few cases like that where they look like regular people, but the technology surrounding them falls into, you know, a completely wilder category.
There was also an incident in which, when I was living in our little condo in Texas we lived in for a couple of years, I was lying in bed in the afternoon. I was getting ready to take a nap when I suddenly heard a voice in my head saying that they were going to kidnap me. It was shocking because I don't hear voices in my head. I've heard two in my life, and one was done in an experience in February of 1987 in upstate New York, and this was the second one. I knew immediately that this was not something that was being generated inside me. It was like a radio voice coming from outside, so I leaped up, ran onto the porch beside the bed, beside the bedroom, rather. There was a little French doors, and you could go out onto a porch, and we were on the ground floor. And there beside the room stood two men, one tall man, not unusually tall, and a shorter man. And they had an instrument that someone in the military had once told me about, which was an instrument that could project, using microwaves, could project audible signals into a person's head. They immediately turned, ran down to the street, jumped into a black Ford Mustang and drove off. Now, I know from reading your book that there are a lot of other cases along these lines.
Mm-hmm.
Who are these people? Can you speculate about that?
Well, I mean, that's the big question. Who's sort of, provoking this? Who's running the program? And from all the various people I interviewed for the book, it seems to me that what we're talking about, we're not talking directly about the government, you know, as one sort of, combined entity that's looking into this. You know, I'd be very surprised if even 0.1% of people within government know anything about this. But what I think is happening is that there's, and this is reflected by the testimony, I think there's a small organization, project, think tank, however you want to term it, that is, for various reasons, sort of deeply concerned about the abduction phenomenon and has, in varying ways over the last few decades, taken a deep interest in the abductees, their experiences, their encounters, and somebody has significant funding to allow for this surveillance program to go on. And I think it's clearly buried extremely deeply within the intelligence / military communities. And I think that's what we're dealing with, like a very deeply buried but incredibly orchestrated and controlled and hidden group that, for reasons perhaps that we don't fully understand, view this issue as of being of national security proportions. And I don't sort of exaggerate when I say that. I think some of them do view it from that perspective.
Free Dreamlanders, enjoy these messages. We'll be right back. You know what you ought to think about doing? You ought to think about going to Strieber.com and looking at some of the books that are available there. There is some amazing stuff, things that you've probably overlooked, like The Path, the only book of its kind in the world, the most remarkable insight into the Tarot that I've ever read or heard about. Even though I wrote it myself, there is nothing like it. The Communion Letters, Ann Strieber's great compilation of letters from Close Encounter witnesses. We're talking about Close Encounters today, and some of these letters, now they're about 20 years old, most of them, but boy, are they ever fantastic, and are they ever up to date. So if you haven't gotten either one of these books, go to Strieber.com and get them today. They are well worth your time. We're talking to Nick Redfern. His new book, Top Secret, Alien Abduction Files, What the Government Does Not Want You to Know. You can reach Nick on, remind me of your blog, Nick.
It's World of Whatever. If you just type in Nick Redfern, World of Whatever, that'll take you directly to the blog.
Oh, great. Okay, so definitely do that if you want to get involved with Nick's journey, which is quite a journey, I think. Now, let me ask you this. I want to shift gears a little bit. I want to know your impressions of what the motives of the abductors, the apparent alien abductors, may be. I know you don't address this very directly in the book, but you're bound to have thought about it.
Sorry, are you asking about the abductees?
No, I'm asking why do you think people are being abducted?
Oh, okay. Well, this gets into some very sort of bizarre and sometimes disturbing scenarios, which I think is what, more than anything else, has provoked the surveillance. Now, when you look at the sort of the standard angle, if you like, of abductions, you know, it's people taken on board a craft, subjected to military, what I think is going on is something that a lot of people don't necessarily appreciate the importance and significance of, and it's something which I think has provoked this surveillance. Now, in the sort of standard alien abduction situation, you have people taken in the middle of the night from their beds, from their cars, subjected to medical experimentation, DNA, etc., etc. Now, if that was all there was to it, I think that would provoke interest on the part of someone within government, the idea of people being kidnapped against their will. But one of the factors which that really sort of resonated with me when I first read communion was how abductees like yourself were talking about things like, for example, connections between the UFO phenomenon and life after death and karma and fate and things like that. And I've got over the years more and more of those kind of cases where people have talked about being on board a UFO and they have almost in like a near-death experience where they've been looking down at their body on the table that's and with the small greys around it, but they're sort of not like their soul, their life force, if you like, looking down at them. And when you look at these kind of cases, the more and more I dig into them, and what a lot of the interviewees for the book told me was that it seemed as if the greys, for want of a better term, had some sort of deep interest or obsession with the human soul. And that was something that cropped up in several of the cases I investigated where the abductees specifically were talking about this issue. And in some cases, when they were directly approached by people from government, that was one of the first questions that popped up. Have you had any dreams about your soul being extracted from your body, or nightmarish dreams of apocalyptic events and you know, your soul being extracted, things like this. So I think whatever that is at the heart of the abduction phenomenon, I don't think it's just a case of, oh, we need their DNA because, you know, or they need our DNA because the greys are on a spiraling situation where they're no longer able to reproduce, etc. You know, that's the sort of the conventional angle. But I think really, from my perspective, we should be focusing more on this kind of soul angle, afterlife, fate, karma angle, which really a lot of people in ufology just want it to be nuts and bolts UFOs. But it's way beyond that. And I think there are people in government who know that, and they're trying to get a handle on this far weirder side, if you like.
You know, a couple of things that have happened just recently are really interesting to me. First, some Harvard scientists have said that Oumuamua object that passed through the solar system from interstellar space recently may well have been an alien spacecraft using a light sail as its means of propulsion. And the reason they thought that is that it accelerates at a very gradual but steady rate as it nears the sun and then goes past it. In other words, it's like it's using the sunlight to increase its speed. Now, number two, a NASA scientist has said to SETI publicly, they should take UFOs seriously. Now, just breaking, and you can see it on Unknown Country this week, folks, is a story about some unusual radar tracks that were seen over the central United States. And yesterday evening, we're recording this on the 12th, so this was the evening of the 11th. I was driving south on the Pacific Coast Highway towards Santa Monica and saw a very bright square object drop down out of the sky. It had a slight tail, but the shape of it suggested it was something other than a meteor. Now, I thought to myself, when those scientists first reported, the Harvard scientists, that object may have been an alien craft, that it might not be long before we saw manifestations on the planet. If they noticed us, they may very well have sent additional probes or even an expedition here. But I don't think there'll be anything like what we've been experiencing. And I think if that's true, they're going to be a lot of very confused people, because this is liable to be something much more like what we would do if we found people from another planet, not like what is happening to us, which where the aliens and the dead seem to be dancing a waltz together, which is, it's very weird, I agree. So I guess I've talked a bit about something that is just breaking, and I wonder if you could respond and, you know, with your thoughts.
Well, yeah, I think, you know, the idea of sort of alien-human communion, if you like, no pun intended, you know, like when we finally meet aliens, or for those people who already have, you know, I think the biggest realization is that it's not like, you know, the likes of Star Trek or something, when, you know, they just meet aliens that look like us and talk like us. And
have a little bit of plastic on their faces to make them sort of formally appear strange.
Yes. And I think the reality, which we're seeing, and thankfully, you know, when you have people like abductees coming forward, it's clear that they're not just alien, they're really alien. You know, they're sort of, they're so far out that trying to have some sort of meaningful face-to-face conversation is just not possible. You know, it's almost like trying to explain your TV set to your pet dog. You know, the dog can see the TV, but it'll never really understand what it is or even care because it has a different mindset. And I think, you know, although it's a simple analogy, I think it's something along those lines that whatever the greys and these other entities are, they are so different to us that it really is difficult to have a one-to-one situation with them. And the concept of being in the presence of something that's highly evolved, but which is so beyond us, you know, I think that's one of the big hurdles that we face. And a lot of people kind of take, you know, the far more simplistic approach of, if it's friendly, you know, it's going to be like E.T., and if it's hostile, it's going to be Independence Day. And I don't think it's either scenario. I think we're dealing with something which, within the government, they're struggling to understand why things like the soul and fate and all this kind of stuff, why this comes into an issue which perhaps back in the 40s and 50s, they had no comprehension that things like that would even be tied to the subject. And I think we're now seeing, particularly with the abduction phenomenon, that the alien phenomenon, if you like, really is beyond what most people would ever have imagined, you know, in relation to UFO research.
Pre-Dreamlanders, I've got some exciting news. Listen up.
Aloha, Jeremy Vaney here, and I want to tell you about my latest undertaking, OurUndoing.com. OurUndoing.com is a multimedia website where if you watch, if you read, if you listen, without trying to absorb knowledge like we do with normal learning, and without the normal judgmental filters that we use to compare and contrast so-called spiritual knowledge, if we watch, if we read, if we listen, without all of that, we may just wake up to our full human nature. That is what this website is for. It's not about what we're doing, it's about who we are, truly are, when we're off the pendulum of duality. If your life is about seeking truth above all else, look no further. Join me at OurUndoing.com.
Whitley Strieber has published an incredible 2-volume historical novel called In Hitler's House, under his open pseudonym Jonathan Lane. This amazing story follows the life of William Weber, who meets Hitler while touring Germany in 1931 and becomes his friend and confidant, but then, when he realizes the truth, becomes a spy in Hitler's house for the Allies. Living a life of terrible danger, he falls in love with another of Hitler's secret friends, also a spy in his house. This is a story of espionage and desperate love, and the deepest portrait of Adolf Hitler ever created. Don't miss In Hitler's House, available in paperback and as an ebook on Amazon.
You've probably heard the music for years. It's the theme song for Dreamland. But you may not know the name of the piece, The O of Pleasure. Or the name of the composer, Ray Lynch. Ray Lynch is a 3-time Billboard Award winner. Ray is also the composer of the platinum album, Deep Breakfast. Pandora calls Ray one of the most influential artists in New Age pop and adult alternative circles. for music that will move your heart and set your spirit soaring, visit www.raylynch.com.
We're talking to Nick Redfern, Alien Abduction Files, Top Secret Alien Abductions. This is a neat book, folks. He lays a lot of things out. He knows what he's doing, Nick. All of his books are like this. They're beautifully laid out. They get right to the point. It's not a huge long book. It's something you can read. Nick, have they ever go up on Audible.com?
Yeah, most of my books from about the last 5 or 6 years are on Audible, and a number of them, including the new book, are available on CD box sets as well for people who enjoy CD listening. So, you know, there's various different ways that that people can access the book.
Because, you know, more and more people are listening to books on Audible. I know I have the Audible app, and I listen to it all the time. So, great. It's nice to know that. Now, let's talk about some specific encounters, if you will, and maybe we can dimensionalize this a little bit. And you lay out a number of them. I'm just sort of going from one to another. How about Judy Doherty, which is a fascinating encounter that was researched by a wonderful researcher, Dr. Leo Sprinkle.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, I guess more than anything else, you know, this really gets to the, you know, the heart of the whole abduction phenomenon in terms of its sort of sheer weirdness. Now, the story of Judy Doherty goes back to May 1973, and it was late at night, and she was driving near Houston, Texas, and she saw a UFO, like a disc-shaped UFO, classic flying saucer. Now, in the wake of that, she started to have a series of really serious nightmarish dreams. And there was also a classic period of missing time, as it's become known. And as you said, you know, she was hypnotized by Dr. Leo Sprinkle. And it turned out that a certain part of the experience from her had been erased from her conscious memory, at least. And she describes seeing a calf being taken aboard a UFO. And it was almost as if it was sort of being sucked into the sky. And also that she was taken on board the craft as well. Now, from there, we know that Kirtland Air Force Base in New Mexico took a deep interest in the story of Judy Doherty. And it sounds very much like that when she was abducted, it was pure chance that a cattle mutilation was going on at the very time when she quite literally stumbled upon this event taking place. So in other words, it was a cattle mutilation abduction, so to speak, but it was also an abduction of Judy Doherty for just essentially, I guess, for being in the wrong place at the right time. So that's one of the, you know, the more intriguing classic cases from the 70s, where you have not just the abduction experience, but you have a deep interest taken in the case on the part of intelligence personnel at Kirtland Air Force Base.
And how do we know that?
Which part?
Oh, that the intelligence personnel took interest.
Oh, well, that actually came as a result of doing research that followed on from Greg Bishop's book, Project Beta. Greg, when he wrote that book on Paul Benowitz back in 2005, you know, it contained a lot of information and a lot of data. And I filed a few FOIA requests for material and got a few pages on Benowitz. But also from there, when I was actually writing about the Benowitz story in one of my later books, I actually got quite a bit of feedback from a few people. And one of them was a Mr. Stigliano, who I mention in the book. And he was able to sort of fill some of the gaps as it related to this Kirtland aspect of the story. Now, Stigliano I have to admit, I don't know if it's his real name or not, but I was able to have a face-to-face meeting with him in Arizona a few years ago in Phoenix. And he, you know, he came across as who he claimed to be, as a retired intelligence officer, and shared a fascinating story as to how, well, I'll get to the main point. One of the main reasons why I felt his story was genuine, because he actually wasn't trying to portray himself as someone who had all the answers. It was basically along the lines of, well, we know something's going on. We think there could be some kind of national security issue surrounding all this. We're kind of concerned about this, as I said earlier, the afterlife connection and things like this. And we don't really know how to handle it. You know, for me, if it was somebody who, you know, like a Walter Mitty type, it would have been far more me, and I've got all the answers, et cetera, et cetera. But it wasn't like that. It was almost as if the angle or the image that he his words provoked were more along the lines of, well, you know, we're struggling to find the answers, but we're doing our best. So, you know, that did come across as sort of more logical and believable, you know.
Yeah, I guess it is that they're basically trying to follow this in order to understand it.
Yes, and I don't think they have all the answers. I think they've got a huge amount of data, but having a lot of data doesn't necessarily mean you've got a lot of answers. All it tells the government, to a degree at least, is that the government knows that, you know, it's an ongoing phenomenon, and a huge number of people have been abducted. And I think these weirder aspects disturb the government and unsettle them, and because it's not something they expected, you know. And I guess it's something that most people in ufology never expected, you know, to have this crossover between the greys and the afterlife. And
right.
You know, and I think that could be, I have no way to prove it, but I think that angle, because it pops up in several of the, well, actually a lot of the stories in the book, I think it's that angle which has, whatever this little project is, this group within government, that angle more than any other one seems to be the one that worries them.
When we get back, Free Dreamlanders, we're going to be talking about hybrids. We'll be right back.
The new unknowncountry.com is on the way. There'll be exciting new graphics, much easier navigation, the ability to subscribe either with your credit card or using PayPal, the return of our free message board and subscriber chat room, and so much more. The new site will be intuitive and easy to use, but it will also be demonstrated and explained on Whitley's YouTube channel. As to when, well, we're hopefully just weeks away.
The Afterlife Revolution is getting great reviews. There's a tremendous, lovely response to it, and I'm so pleased and humbled, because it's an effort on the part of myself and Anne. And I love Anne so much. I want her to succeed in this incredible task that she has undertaken of returning and communicating across the bridge between the worlds. And she's really doing it. This is a real thing that's happening. Listen to some of these reviews. Anne and Whitley Strieber lay out their life's work in the most exquisitely beautiful manner. This moving book comes from the heart, the unified heart of two people who have dedicated their lives in this realm and the next to revealing the nature of consciousness as it makes its sojourn in this human form. That's just one. Here's another. I love, love this book. It's a wonderful read, especially if you lost somebody very close to you. Just incredible. Here's another one. The book shows you how to grow your soul, for lack of a better term. Through Anne's insight, Whitley shares invaluable information that could only be from the other side. So take it seriously. Go to Amazon and get Afterlife Revolution. Go on to Amazon and get the Afterlife Revolution in paperback or in Kindle format. And if you have questions or thoughts, write me at whitley@strieber.com. I'm right here. I'm ready to answer anything you ask to help you in any way I can, always. We're talking to Nick Redfern, his new book, Alien Abduction Files. You can reach Nick on the internet as well. Nick, can you give us your internet address?
Yeah, if you Google Nick Redfern, World of Whatever, that will take you directly to my blog.
Great. Okay, because I always, when I mention addresses, for some reason, it gets the blog gets far fewer hits than if the guest mentions the address, we've noticed. So in any case, this is a, there's another aspect to this, which is the aspect of hybrids. Mm-hmm. And this is one of the things that has really worried, I'm sure, the government. In fact, I know it has for this reason. I was told back in the early 90s by a person involved with the Senate Intelligence Committee that the great fear of the government was that aliens who looked human or were hybridized would get into positions of power because they were indistinguishable from ordinary people with unknown consequences. And at the time, he also told me that the National Security Agency was reading everything that was being typed on my computer from the World Trade Center, which was visible from my house, which was at that time in Brooklyn Heights. You could actually see the World Trade Center from the house. Obviously, it's gone now, but this was before 9/11. So I told my family this, you're an alien. Unfortunately, it wasn't a joke. I did it. I typed it onto the computer. And the next day, the entire little street we were on, it was just a short street, and it dead-ended at overlooking New York Harbor, was filled with these cars. And normally there weren't many cars parked out there at all, but none of the neighbors, including me, could get parking on the street all of a sudden. And these strange, identical cars with these men all sitting in them were there. So I called the man from the Senate. First, I called a detective, and he called me. I knew, and he called me back, and I gave him the license numbers, the idea being to find out where the cars are from. He said, they're all federal cars. Those are all Ulster County license plates, and that's where they license their cars. So I called the guy from the Senate, and he laughed and said, well, okay, don't worry about it. I'll get rid of them. From that day to this, I have been endlessly harassed. Right now, on my website, we cannot accept new subscribers. And when an old subscriber's subscription runs out, they can continue to use the site because it has been damaged in ways that cannot be repaired easily under the circumstances, and which had to have been done by somebody who had extraordinary and unusual access to it. It's not done by an ordinary hacker. And it is just one of dozens and dozens of things that have happened. I have been oppressed by this for years and years. At this point in time, I can't even get a publisher to publish my books. I have to publish them myself. I'm just about done, actually. Now, you think of that. That's a war. Someone is at war with me, all over a practical joke. And, you know, I can only say this. I can't imagine anyone except some bureaucrat in the United States Intelligence Service getting that crazy about something so insignificant. Or is it so insignificant? Tell me what you think.
Well, I mean, when you mention the whole issue of hybrids, I mean, a couple of things sprung to mind. One being the whole Men in Black mystery, which much of that surrounds the issue of surveillance and so on. But, you know, the Men in Black are clearly not the Men in Black of you know, the movies. They're not Will Smith and Tommy Lee Jones, you know. They can pass for human, but there are just a few things about them that are just a little bit off. You know, if you were to see them up close, they look not quite fully human. And that goes also for the lesser-known Women in Black angle. And also, of course, with the far more recent phenomenon of the so-called black-eyed children, which I think, you know, all of those particular groups, if you like, look human, but there are vague things, or with the black-eyed kids, you know, with the eyes, significantly issues. But, I mean, I've heard things like this before, you know, the idea of aliens or hybrids infiltrating society, that kind of thing. And, I mean, if that's true, again, I can easily see why somebody on the inside would take a deep interest, you know, just that word infiltration, you know, I think is enough to warrant, from their perspective, a reason to look into this further. But I mean, having written a number of books on the Men in Black mystery, one of the things that really does stand out, and which I do find admittedly quite sinister, is that people say, you know, they see these entities, if you like, sort of skulking in the shadows late at night, and the witnesses have said, you know, that with hindsight, they felt it was because they didn't look entirely human, but, you know, in the shadows late at night, it doesn't really matter. You know, they can just about pass as human. And that kind of provokes an image of almost like a secret army of these sort of hybrids, if you like, or human-looking aliens infiltrating us, worming their way in, and to what extent, who knows, you know, but just that angle of whether they're sort of engineered to look like us or they just happen to, I don't know, but just that angle of infiltration, I think, as I said, is enough to get a lot of people kind of antsy as to, well, if, you know, if they look like aliens, that's fine. But if they look like us, that's really difficult.
Well, it gets me back to the two people who implanted me. Mm-hmm. Were they aliens or human?
Mm-hmm.
No way to tell.
Yeah.
No way to tell. They certainly spoke English, at least the man in the backyard who said conditioned red did. Mm-hmm. And they certainly understood it, or he would have used another language. So it's such an unbelievable conundrum, the whole thing. And now we are in a situation where what I would describe as ordinary aliens could be about to show up. And what in the world are they going to think when we begin to react to them as if that they are part of this whole crazy business when they're not, which could be the case?
Well, yeah, and again, you know, all of this just sort of demonstrates the sort of sheer weirdness of the whole situation. And one of the things that really kind of intrigued me, and this also pops up several times in the book and in relation to the Men in Black, is that in some cases the abductees were sort of clandestinely visited by people within government. But then sort of days afterwards, there would be this other sort of far more creepy MIB-type characters following them. In other words, as if there was the government angle of surveillance, but the same people were being watched by these sort of pale-faced, skinny, tall MIB, as if there was like another group outside of government, but watching the same people, which goes into, you know, really strange avenues.
Let's talk about the Myrna Hansen case, because it takes this to another level. Tell us what happened to Myrna, and then where she went.
Well, yeah, I mean, this is another story with sort of classic overtones attached to it in relation to surveillance and so on. Now, Myrna Hansen's case, it goes back to May 1980, and she was heading towards Eagle Nest, New Mexico. She'd been over to Oklahoma and was heading back home. And she had, you know, sort of a typical abduction experience, you know, when you're in a vehicle, kind of like the Betty and Barney Hill case, which is sort of, the perfect example. And, excuse me. And very much like the Judy Doherty case, Myrna Hansen says she saw like a small cow, a calf, being taken into a UFO, sort of literally raised from the ground, but not, you know, with ropes or pulleys or anything like that. It was as if it was sort of levitated into the craft. Now, what's intriguing is that Myrna Hansen said that subsequent to actually seeing this cow being lifted into the UFO, she was taken to some sort of underground facility or base, whatever you want to call it, where aliens reportedly implanted her with some kind of device, which was assumed to be a tracking device. But what takes it down an even stranger path is that Kirtland Air Force Base intelligence personnel got onto this story as well. Now, Hansen described the inside of this underground facility she was taken to, and several of the guys who were interviewing her but basically became sort of pale and ashen because they realized she was actually describing one of the highest security underground facilities at Kirtland Air Force Base, and she described it perfectly. But of course, you know, she should never have been in an off-limits underground facility below Kirtland Air Force Base. And of course, you know, most military bases do have bunkers, you know, for storage of
absolutely,
you know, important material. But she was actually able to describe the place itself. And the military was never really able to, at least the ones that interviewed her, were never really able to, you know, figure out how she was so able to describe how it looked. And there were all sorts of different theories, one being that she'd been taken there and had this experience in almost like an out-of-body experience, that she didn't actually go there, but her soul did. Now, I don't think we need to go down that path there, but it does seem more hers was like a physical nuts and bolts kind of experience. Then you had the far more controversial idea that, yes, she was taken to this underground installation at Kirtland and was sort of probed and prodded and experimented on by aliens who were actually being sort of overseen, if you like, or the other way around, by the military. You know, this sort of idea of a liaison between the two, but below Kirtland, which is, you know, admittedly an extremely controversial scenario. But all we can say for sure is, and it's an important sure, is that, you know, she had an abduction experience, had an implant-type device placed inside her, and she was 100% able to describe the place she was taken to, which really was, from the description, you know, 40-50-60 feet below Kirtland Air Force Base.
Which is a fascinating thing, because the aliens could have been, if they are that, could have been, in a sense, pulling the leg of the intelligence officers by causing the woman to believe that she had been in that space when, in fact, she hadn't. And just to let them know how powerful they were. Or it could be that she was there. It could even be that there's an active program going on there, because there's so many stories of interaction between us and them underground. How much credibility do you give those stories? Are there any particular ones that you think are credible?
Well, I mean, you're right. There are a lot of stories about underground aliens and things like this, but what I find intriguing, sort of a slightly alternative aspect to this, is that, you know, you can go back centuries, particularly in England and mainland Europe, you know, of the stories of the little people and the fairies and so on, and how they, you know, would live in these underground realms, and you know, they would take people and take them to the fairy kingdom because their race was dwindling and dying out. So, you know, some man's taken into the fairy kingdom, has sex with the queen of the fairies to try and, you know, beef their stock up again, so to speak. So, you know, I mean, this angle of, you know, fairies, goblins being parallels to today's aliens, I think there's something to that. And, you know, just the fact that with these sort of little magical creatures centuries ago perceived as what today we call fairies and things like that. You know, I think the idea that we're looking at the same kind of phenomenon but being perceived in different ways by different cultures and throughout different centuries, I think that's a valid one. And I think the fact that in many of these stories, the little people in centuries ago lived underground. And I don't think that's a coincidence that today we have tales of underground aliens. I think it's sort of, it's the same thing. But, you know, back then it was perceived as something more magical. Today it's something more technological.
At our cabin, it was clear that they came up from underground. They even smelled, some of them, like the forest floor when you got near them. And yet, when I had my close encounter experience, one of my neighbors saw the experience happen. At least we believe it was my experience. And I was in a thing that looked like the Goodyear blimp hanging over a field near our houses. Unfortunately, he never wanted his name to be mentioned at all, and so that's all I can say about it. But nevertheless, it was so. There's kind of both things seem to be involved, but you know, in Bavaria, there are hundreds of tunnels that are apparently they believe to have been created in the Middle Ages. But many of them are too small for a human being to move through and would have had to have been created by children. But for what reason? At the same time in that area, there were rich legends of the so-called kobolds, these dark blue figures that lived in mines that we now see frequently. I see them quite frequently, and I've seen them all my life. But they aren't there now. In other words, those tunnels have been empty for hundreds of years. And I'm thinking that maybe there is something to the idea that they are dying out, that they are basically a species of an earthly species from some, or perhaps an alien species that came to Earth a long time ago and are dying out or leaving, maybe. I mean, it's hard to know.
Yeah, well, I think one of the reasons why this angle of the little people of, you know, centuries ago has been dismissed by so many is because of the image that people have today of, like, goblins and fairies, you know, sort of little characters with wings flitting around the Christmas tree, that kind of thing.
Yeah, well, also, the UFO researchers don't want it to look funny and
weird. Yeah, exactly,
weird.
That's what it is.
You know, they don't like that, but they'd rather it looked real than true.
Yeah.
Essentially.
But one of the important things is if you actually go back and read the original stories from centuries ago of fairies and goblins and the little people, they were actually nothing like Tinkerbell or anything like that. It was more along the lines they were sort of small, dwarfish creatures that would live underground. They would come out at night and sometimes steal babies and change them for what's known as a changeling would be put in its place. And, you know, they would live underground, they would come out at night, and they could be friendly, dangerous, or they could be very manipulative and almost trickster-like. So when you look at it from that perspective, you know, the thing that has made so many people, as you said, stay away within ufology from the whole issue of, you know, fairies and goblins is because of the sort of picture book image that people have them of them today, which is far removed from the much more sinister little characters that really did sort of act not unlike at all the greys of today in terms of abductions and that kind of thing.
Right. It's fascinating. but, you know, indeed, the fairy lore is full of abduction tales that not only involve abductions, but also missing time. But I want to go on. Well, I'd like to talk about missing time very briefly because I have something that happened to me in May of 2017 at LAX, Los Angeles Airport. My listeners know most of this story, so I'll just be brief about what happened. I got off of a plane and arrived at the baggage claim 45 minutes later with no idea of where I had been. It felt like I just walked directly from the plane to the baggage claim area. But there's no question at all that there was a 45-minute delay.
Wow.
It was 45 minutes on my watch, and the baggage claim area was abandoned. Everybody had already gone, and my bag was sitting there near the baggage office waiting for me because I had been gone so long, and they'd taken it off the carousel. So now that said, the question was, what happened? And interestingly enough, I tried hypnosis for this, and it didn't work. But now I have remembered it very clearly, very clearly. And what happened was basically I had a discussion and was in the presence of someone prior to the flight who is one of the few people who has ever been told anything directly about the bodies that were found at Roswell. I know some of this material also, but I was asked not to ever speak of it, so I don't. And this person was in the same boat, but we did compare notes. And the individual who contacted me and placed me into this state sat with me in one of the gates and talked to me about the conversation the two of us had and wanting to know what we knew. And that was it.
Wow.
So, as far as the individual is concerned, he looked perfectly human. He was a very nice man, in fact, and very sweet and apologetic about how he had done it. And he had done it by activating me that was done to me in France many years ago, where two French, I guess they were intelligence officers, came to the apartment I was living in when I was alone there. I was with my wife and kids. We were on a vacation with an apartment instead of a hotel, and told me they could induce missing time and would like to interview me while I was in that state.
Huh.
And they said that they could not leave me a tape of it, but I would remember it, but not for long. And it was so seamless that the next thing I knew, they were saying, would you like to listen to it? I didn't have any idea it had even happened. But then the clock clearly had, I'd lost 30 minutes just standing there. It was extraordinary. They said it was done with a tone. And what I remember about the tape, which I swore I would remember forever, was that it made me very happy. I went rushing into the back to take notes, but by the time I was ready to take notes, I couldn't take notes. I couldn't remember a thing. But I have remembered now what happened at LAX, and I'm hoping to remember more over time. And so now let's go on to black helicopters. Because I have an interesting story that involves Ed Conroy. What do you think? Now, first, set the scene for us a little bit about black helicopters, just in general.
Yeah, sure. Just before I quickly get to that, just coincidentally, this past weekend, I actually saw Ed. I was lecturing on the book down in Austin, and he drove up, and we had a good chat.
Oh, yeah, that's right. He mentioned that in an email to me.
Yeah. But,
he's a wonderful man.
Yeah, good guy.
Yeah.
And the whole issue of the black helicopter phenomenon sort of goes back to the latter part of the 60s, but certainly it was at its height onwards from the sort of mid to late 70s. Now, it basically revolves around people, predominantly abductees, but also UFO researchers, and also in relation to the cattle mutilation phenomenon as well, where people report seeing these completely black helicopters. And when I say completely black, I mean there are literally no markings, no identifying markings on the craft themselves, which in itself is actually illegal to fly a helicopter or any kind of aircraft, you know, without identifying markings. But very often, in relation to the abductees, the black helicopters will fly sort of perilously close to people's homes, and which really comes across like a form of intimidation more than anything else. I don't think in most cases it's due to sort of surveillance, you know, trying to see what's going on in the house. I really think it is a kind of a way to intimidate and frighten people and to let them know that, hey, we're watching you. And now, if there were just one or two cases of black helicopters in association to abductions, I would probably be inclined to think, well, you know, it was just a military helicopter flying by somebody, flying by the house of somebody who happened to be an abductee, and that just might happen now and again. But the sheer numbers of these cases are incredible. And so many abductees have reported, sometimes the larger double-rotor military helicopters, and then others have described smaller ones. But the one thing they have in common is this inability on the part of the witness to identify them, because there's just no way to identify them. And again, I think this kind of ties in with this group within governments I'm talking about, that is sort of a quick reaction, deeply buried secret organization that responds to these events incredibly quickly and has been doing so and continues to do so.
Well, interestingly enough, a few months ago, I had such an experience. I'm not sure that it is the helicopter wasn't black. I think it had markings on it, but it was in the evening and it was difficult to tell. I did make some video of it flying around me, and I turned and walked up a dark street on purpose to see if the helicopter would follow me, and it did. So that does happen. Now, Ed Conroy had black helicopters coming out of his ears, and when after he started working on Report on Communion, and in fact, when he came up to the cabin, he brought helicopters with him because we didn't see many at the cabin. And then after he left, I was watching Apocalypse Now, which has a lot of helicopter sounds in it. And all of a sudden, the helicopter sounds in the TV seemed to come out into the room. It was a very eerie thing, like I had suddenly gotten ultra-high-end surround sound, which I did not have, obviously. I realized it was coming from outside, and I rushed outside. It was evening, and looked up, and there was this huge helicopter hovering right over the house. And I thought, well, I wonder if they came for Ed too late or what. Anyway, another time, and he tells this story also, Ann and I were in San Antonio to meet with Ed, and we came out of our hotel and in downtown San Antonio and heard helicopters overhead and looked up, and there were two helicopters nose to nose with their blades intertwined, flying low over the city. And we could not believe our eyes. And I watched as they moved away to see whether or not, once I could see them at an angle, if they weren't at different altitudes. But they weren't. They were nose to nose. And when we got to Ed, when we were meeting for breakfast, he was flabbergasted because he had seen them too. And this is impossible. It can't be done. I called the FAA at the San Antonio airport and asked if that was possible. And the guy said, oh, my God, no. Their rotors would break and they'd both crash. Mm-hmm. So,
well,
is it a method of intimidation? Or what the heck is it? Are they able to read something from our minds or something?
Well, I mean, one of the weirder things about the black helicopter phenomenon, you know, the angle of being watched by totally black helicopters, you know, with no markings or anything, for some abductees, that might actually be quite intimidating. But there's another aspect to it, which takes it down even weirder avenues, and that's where people have said they've seen these black helicopters sort of morph into different shapes. I've got some cases where they describe the helicopter turning into like a classic flying saucer, and also vice versa. And in other cases, they transformed into like a large ball of light, as if it was almost sort of like a stealthy camouflage of whose side, you know, I don't know. But there are enough of those sort of morphing black helicopter stories to suggest it is a real phenomenon. But, you know, whether it's a creation of the military, or whether, you know, we're looking at even bizarre situations and scenarios where the phenomenon itself, you know, manipulates something to look like something familiar when it actually isn't.
Well, we have come to the end of our time together today. Nick, it's been really wonderful, lots of fun, and fascinating. Nick Redfern's book is Top Secret, Alien Abduction Files, What the Government Doesn't Want You to Know. And apparently what they don't want you to know is everything. So, and yet here we are out here on the front line, all of us who have had these experiences, and all of us others as well, because these experiences in the end mean something that we don't understand and that we're not told about. And that is wrong. That is very simply wrong. We deserve to know more. Maybe we don't deserve to know the whole thing and the whole story, but at least we deserve to know what is being kept from us about what happens to us. Nick, thank you.
All right. Thanks a lot, Luke.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host, and I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander. Thank you for listening.